This is Steve Downs, the voice of Master Chief, Sierra 117, and you're listening to Podcast Unlocked, the world's number one Xbox podcast. Now, finish this fight. Master Chief, out.
Welcome, everybody. It's Podcast Unlocked, IGN's weekly Xbox show. It's the 629th time we've done this. Now, we haven't all been here for all 629, but I've been here for most of those, which is pretty cool. And I'm happy to be joining you once again. I'm joined by Destin Legarry. You know him. You love him. Hi, Destin.
Bam. Hey, everybody.
And a longtime friend of IGN. I'm not sure if this is your first Unlocked appearance or not. You'll have to tell me. Travis, the Thai guy, Northup. Good to see you, sir.
Good to see you too, Ryan. Happy to be here. And yes, this is, I think, completing my infinity gauntlet of IGN podcasts. So this is a bucket list. Longtime listener of Podcast Unlocked and super excited to be here.
We are thrilled to have you. You did, of course, our Destiny show with Destin for a long time. That game's still going, guys. So let's get the show going back again. What's going on? Come
on. No, nope.
Yeah, Destin, let's do it
for all of you guys.
No, I do not like Destiny very much anymore.
I still play it. I'm a slave.
Called Fire Team Chat. Oh, but no, it's all good. We are here to talk Xbox here on Podcast Unlocked, and I wanted to open the show by going over four new release games. A couple of which we've spent a little time with, and one of which, the big reason why Travis is here, because we also just like him. He's a nice guy, but he's played the most of. Destin's also spent time with it, too. So we're going to talk about Prince of Persia, The Lost Crown, Like a Dragon, Infinite Wealth, Tekken 8, and then Palworld, which is, of course, the title game of this week's podcast. It is red hot, and we're going to talk plenty about it. But I did want to open with Prince of Persia, The Lost Crown. I've spent about three-ish hours with this. Have either of you had a chance to dabble at all yet?
No, yes, I did, sir. Not. Two other games I'll talk about later have taken all of my time.
We've suddenly found ourselves, like, the first, three weeks of the month of the new year were totally quiet, which is not unusual for January. And then all of a sudden, boom, here's like four really good games. Travis, I want to hear from you first on your thoughts on Prince of Persia, how much you've gotten a chance to play so far and what you think of it.
Yeah, so because of my very aggressive review schedule, this is sort of a game I'm playing in my spare time. So I'm probably about as far as you, Ryan, maybe a little bit farther in the 3 to 5 hour kind of period. But so far, I mean, I love this genre. I love Metroidvanias, and this is sort of like right up there with, you know, Ori and the Blind Forest and some of the more modern 2D Metroidvania games I love, Metroid Dread, except for this one speaks to me especially because it has a little bit of like that sweaty, try hard reaction time, perfect parrying stuff that I really like in combat that has you super involved. So I'm really excited to play more, but everybody I know who has played through this entire game or our reviewer that has really, really enjoyed it and loved it. So I think I'm going to find myself in that category when all things are said and done. But a very, very strong start and opening hours. And I love the style and swagger this game has. It's really cool.
By the way, quick non sequitur, only because you mentioned Ori and the Blind Forest. My daughter started playing it. She was like, hey, do you have this? Like she heard about it somewhere somehow. And it was like, yeah, we've got it on Xbox. You can play. She starts digging into it. And then she gets to the water tower and she's like, Dad, can you help me? I'm like, yeah, it's the hardest part of the game. I did make it, but it took me a lot. So let's try it. And I tried it a bunch and got right to the end and just couldn't get that last dash. And then so I was like, I got to go back to making our lunch. And then I hear, I did it. And it was like the most, I think the most proud gamer dad moment I've had so far, that she cleared the water tower in Ori and the Blind Forest. So
she is now officially a hardcore gamer. If she
can
beat the water tower.
All the way in, all the way down the rabbit hole. But yeah, Prince of Persia, The Lost Crown. I had previewed this and I may have already given my thoughts on those first few hours on another Unlocked after that preview embargo had lifted. But yeah, now that it's out and everybody's playing it, I've not heard a bad word about this game yet. It is just it's insane how well Prince of Persia takes to the Metroidvania formula. It's really just a great fit. It is surprising at how tough it is. Like, it's not joking around, which I guess in hindsight, or at least if I stop to think about it more than hindsight, really, it's the original game was no joke either. I don't know if either of you have ever gone back and played the original Prince of Persia, but there's no safety net. You're screwed if you messed up in that one.
I played the original and that cel-shaded one that came a few years later.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, there have been some tough Prince of Persia games, but this one is right up there with the original, I think. And yeah, in the first 3 hours, I think I had counted, I believe there are four boss fights in the first 3 hours, including the one kind of right around the 3 hour mark is like a mega boss fight with multiple phases. And I forget, it's like a big, like, what is it? Like a centaur thing? I don't remember what the hell it is, but some mythical thing. That took a lot, but then you get that feeling of satisfaction when you finish it off. So yeah, if you're starting the new year and looking for something interesting to play that you hadn't really considered, Prince of Persia: The Lost Crown is legit. It looks great, runs great on anything, but certainly on Xbox. And yeah, it's good times. Second game on the list, I confess I have not spent any time with. This is another one I've heard not a single negative word about, and it is Like a Dragon: Infinite Wealth. I open the floor to either of you two gentlemen if you've had a chance to spend any time with this. If not, we can move along. But it's this got a 9 out of 10 from IGN.
To
start the conversation there.
Yeah, I will start because I'm a huge fan of both the Yakuza franchise, but I also have every achievement in Like a Dragon on Xbox from the original, which if you know the achievement in that game, that is a serious commitment. This is one of those games I loved so much. I was just looking for excuses to keep playing it. And so getting all the achievements was that excuse. Infinite Wealth, I've basically only done, you know, the opening 30-40 minute period because I've been busy with Palworld. But I suspect that this is more of what the studio does extremely well, and that Ichiban Kasuga is my favorite new character in the last decade, and I'm so excited to see more of him because I actually prefer him to Kiryu, and I also prefer the turn-based model to the arcade fighting. I'm really, really excited to play more. I have no problem at all believing that this is a 9 out of 10. That's probably what I would have given it if I reviewed it, just based on how much I like the first one. So I'm really excited to play more, guys. And I'm really excited that these games come to Xbox because I tend to play most of my games here. And this is sort of one of the studios that has been most supportive of the platform. I really like this thing. So I'm excited to play more.
Yeah. Hey, Destin, I can't think of really a lot of franchises at all that change the name, change their name and sort of like pivot, but not really. Like, and I certainly can't think of anybody that's done that better than going from Yakuza to Like a Dragon. It's like that. It's seems like it's gaining momentum with each new release.
Yeah, I think the only one I ever played was Yakuza 0, and that's because they had the entire, like, all the games came to Xbox Game Pass at one point. Yeah. And I'm like, well, I'll start out with the first one. 0 was like a remake or something like that for the original game, and they're really, really, really fun. And to see them sort of continue as long as they have and take some chances with the core design philosophy and make it fun and interesting in new ways without changing it too much, like, it's perfect. I'm really, really happy to see that they continue to be successful. I don't think there's been like a bad one that I've seen. I've never seen anybody really complain about this franchise.
Yeah. And go ahead, Travis.
Yeah, I was going to say, as for the name change, I believe this is one of those games like Resident Evil, where Like a Dragon is their studio name. And I think that's what the series is called in Japan. And so it's sort of like Resident Evil Biohazard, where,
right,
you know, that now suddenly it was going by the Japanese name. So it is, I will say this, their naming conventions are extremely confusing to American audiences, myself included, as somebody who follows it and knowing which game is a part of which canon and chronology and all that is very confusing, but that's sort of weirdly on brand in a meta way with the game in general. If you played them, they're just like obtuse and weird and confusing, and that's kind of part of the charm. So yeah, it is a little weird though.
I thought you made a great point too, Travis, about how supportive Sega has been as an overall publisher towards Xbox. I mean, going back to the original Xbox, when like the original Xbox kind of became like the pseudo Dreamcast 2, basically. You had why am I blanking? I'm blanking on the big cool open world game. From Dreamcast, and then the second one was on Xbox. Why am I completely blanking
Lost,
on the name of it?
Lost.
Not Lost.
No, from Sega. From this is like, now I'm embarrassed that I'm so, like, what is the name? It's going to haunt me.
He's going to lose his mind.
It's instantly in the comments, of course, and everybody's like screaming at me. But anyway, Panzer Dragoon, of course, on original Xbox. Jet Set Radio on original Xbox.
That's the one
Xbox.
I was thinking of.
And that has just continued. There was the game I'm thinking of had a crowdfunded third game that like generated a ton of money.
Why am I forgetting the dude's name? It's the guy's name. He's the, why am I forgetting? Oh no, you've infected me.
I've infected you all on, goodness.
They're on Xbox now, though. The original two. Shenmue. Yeah. Shenmue.
That was Shenmue. It. Thank you.
I don't want to say it and be wrong.
Yes.
I was Googling it. Yeah.
That's I'm sure that'll be clipped out and passed around and made. I'm sure all the Xbox zealot militant people will be like, see, he doesn't know anything about Xbox.
You tried doing it live on a show. That's what I say. It's always way harder.
One, guys, okay, take your win on that one. But no,
I was thinking Lost Planet, but that's Capcom.
That's Capcom. Yeah. But yes, Sega really has. It's, you know, it's almost like Sega is at one end of the Japanese publisher support scale for Xbox. Square Enix is at the other end.
Yeah.
At least at the moment, right? So they're
getting better.
We're trying to get more Square Enix stuff onto Xbox, but they're,
we got Mana.
That's like, that's like the opposite ends of the scale at this point in time. Tekken 8 also out, also got a 9 out of 10 on IGN. I don't think any of us have played this one. So I will simply note.
Let's talk about the game we're all playing. Everybody in the world is playing.
We need Mitchell here or Ronnie to talk Tekken.
Ronnie liked it very much.
But yeah, 9 out of 10.
Did Ronnie review it?
Tekken delivers again, which it's, you know, nothing new for that series. Love to see it. I will add, we did an IGN first month of coverage on this game in October. And just sort of, you know, being the IGN first guy that sort of helps get all this stuff onto the website, it is certainly a gorgeous fighting game. It's Unreal Engine 5. It's, the stages are stunning. The characters look great. And from, again, everything I've ever heard about it, the mechanics of it are just sublime. So good stuff from Harada-san and the Tekken Project over there. So a little something for everybody. You've got a Metroidvania. You've got for all intents and purposes, an RPG in Like a Dragon Infinite Wealth. You've got a fighting game. And then the game we come to as our headliner this week, the game that is, it is an Xbox console exclusive for the time being that has proven to be an absolute win for Xbox on the console side, and people are loving it. It's over, at this recording, 7 million players have bought this game. We don't even know. We haven't been given the figure of how many people are playing it on Xbox through Game Pass. But here we go with the Pokemon with Guns survival game, Palworld, which, Travis, you have reviewed for IGN Destin. I know you've spent a little time with it. So I'm going to shut up, and I want to hear you guys talk about this game, because there are a few Xbox-specific issues going on. There's a lot of growing pains with this incredible surge of success out of the gate, but the game itself, also very interesting. So, Travis, I'll start with you.
Yeah. So this is the one of the weirdest games I've played in a good long while, which is a big compliment coming from me because I like weird games. Obviously, we just got done talking about Infinite Wealth. So very much up my alley. This is one that sort of wasn't on anybody's radar. We knew that people had interest in this, but they kind of always do when there's anything that kind of looks like Pokemon. So this is one I volunteered to review because I thought it was going to be bad and I thought that would be fun to review.
You're the bad game guy.
That's sort of turns my out. At this point. But as it turns out, it is not bad, which honestly, that's why I volunteer to review these weird games is because I love being surprised and finding stuff that if it's not successful, it's at least trying stuff new. And so this really is the type of game that speaks to me. But as it turns out, this game is not bad. It is extremely good. We gave it an 8 out of 10. And that is based on over 100 hours with it. Wow. Split between the PC and the Xbox version. I actually just surpassed on the Xbox version where I'm at progress wise on PC, and have essentially completed all of the content that is currently available in the game. It is unfinished. It doesn't really have an ending. The first thing that I think people should know about this game is that it looks like Pokemon. It has a creature collecting element that is sort of front and center, but it actually has more in common with survival games like Grounded or Rust or something like that. And I did get Grounded vibes from this because it has kind of a similar cartoony art style. It is a survival game where you're building bases and trying to survive out in the wild. And all of your children look like, or all of your characters look like children. All of your characters look like children, even if you make them look like old men. So that also is kind of in line with Grounded. So it gave me those vibes, which is another survival game I absolutely love. It basically says, what if there was a survival game where instead of just collecting resources and managing your base yourself, you captured Pokemon-like creatures called pals and put them to work at your camp. And so it has these really cool moments where suddenly you realize that capturing different types of pals helps you run your base better. So you can capture a plant pal, and then that pal will spray seeds in your garden and help you farm. You can capture a water-based pal, and they will water said seeds. And then you can capture a pal that's got claws, and it'll harvest the crop. And suddenly you've got like this automation thing going where your fire pals are helping you cook food and smelting your ore into ingots and
it's
all
like
this
a little Viva
sort of
Pinata
stuff.
In here. Just like just a
yes.
touch of it.
Yes. And so it does have very much, and I'm a huge fan of Viva Pinata as well, by the way. I think it just speaks to me in a lot of different ways of like the survival mechanic. It's got a huge multiplayer component, which you can see now here if
that
you're watching
Mareep.
The video version.
Like, that was like literally Mareep. What?
Yes.
How did get sued? They must have like taken this to their lawyers and like gotten right to the edge where they're like, okay, you're not going to get sued here. And right? Like that's the only way that this can exist.
So I have a friend who is a fellow podcaster that I do a show with every week, and he's also a lawyer. And he talked about, he actually did a video this week about how this is illegal. Richard Hogue. Yeah, you guys know him. He basically said that like if he were these people's lawyer, he would have said that this is farther than he's comfortable with. But he gets the in principle how this could happen, which is, you know, Pikachu is copyrighted, but you can't copyright the idea of an electric mouse. And there is an electric mouse in the game that kind of looks Pikachu. Yeah, of course there is. There's that looks very Pikachu-esque. And so it definitely gets right up to the line. But I think where it saves itself is in a few areas. One, it plays nothing like Pokemon, like not even the open world ones are similar. Here you can see me butchering a pal with a knife so that I can eat it, which is also something you can do in the game. They blur it out for comedy. The game,
you're beating the tar out of that.
All the tropes and jokes that like the internet has made for decades. Right.
Yes, it lets you do things like you can capture humans in the game. If you find another human that is messing with you, you can trap him in a pal sphere, and then he'll do your bidding. You can summon him in combat or make him work for you at the base. He's just bound to your will. It lets you, you know, butcher and eat your pals if you are running low on food and you need some meat to survive. Pals that include humans, you can eat them too if you're that type of player. It really leans into the darkness and the comedy. And so it almost, you know, it can almost claim to fall under parody law in how close it comes to Pokemon. So it's a very fun and amusing game, and just if you like kind of stupidity and also just a great survival game, it's a load of laughs, especially with friends. On PC it's up to 32 players, Xbox up to 4, but honestly, like, 4 is plenty. 4 is enough to have like a riotous good time in multiplayer, and it's addictive, man. It's one of those games that's got that just one more hour. Once I get this thing done, once I level up to this level and build this thing, I'll stop playing, and you just can't bring yourself to do it. So I played 100 hours in this very easily. It went by very quickly. So
great. It's very fun.
What are your thoughts, Destin?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, like, I don't have nearly as much time, but the game starts you out and it's like, get 10 of each pal. You start doing that. You build up your base gets raided, and then they set your wood house on fire. Here's some examples of getting raided. And then it challenges you, go take on this first boss. And then you get stuck in this loop of, okay, I need to survive. I need to make sure all my pals have beds. And then as you get more and more powerful, you're stuck in that hook of getting the gun, or I still just have the crossbow, or just chasing the stable of characters that you're able to utilize in battle. And it's hard for me to put my finger on why it works so well, but I really find this game to be tremendously fun. I hope more people play it. I love the absurdity of all the jokes and how it just leans into it. And I am very happy that it has come along seemingly out of nowhere and created a really, really fun loop that I like. It's one of those games where if I start playing it, my day's gone. Then that's it.
Yeah.
Which is a great feeling. Watching this footage and hearing you both talk about it, there's almost, I wonder if I could almost recommend this if you're a State of Decay fan, where it's almost like you're, you know, you've got your network of fellow survivors, manage your base, keep them happy, keep them fed, except it's a cartoonish veneer over it rather than a zombie post-apocalypse. Like, there's maybe just like a little State of Decay, gameplay template here.
I think so. I think it's got, except for in State of Decay, your goal is to keep them happy. In this one, you're almost like a sweatshop worker or sweatshop manager. Like, you're basically like, hey, I don't care if you have mental health issues. If you get too far gone, I'll just chop you up and feed you to the other pals. Like, it kind of encourages you to be the worst. Here's the lightning mouse, by the way, Ryan, in case you were wondering.
Well, that's,
they get real close.
You know, when I talk about how walking the legal line here, it's not just that they have Pokemon-like creatures. It's that those creatures are done in the exact same art style, practically. Yeah. Like, within a couple percent of the Pokemon art style. It's not like they went with a
like Temtem
version. They are round, they are cute, they are colorful. So they're basically Pokemon, and it's hilarious.
It's very good. Great way to spend some of your time or waste your time with friends. And I have to say, I think Xbox, I don't know if I have this timeline exactly correctly, but my recollection is that this was added to announce that it was coming to Game Pass pretty late in the game.
Yes.
And just based on how far behind the Xbox version is from Steam, I'm thinking this is a game that somebody at Microsoft played and was like, dude, this is going to be big. We got to get it. And kudos to them if that's the case, because they were spot on. This is one of those things where, like, when you play it, it just like clicks with you. Mm-hmm. And I think somebody said, you know, this could be our next arc, and which was another huge Xbox game that just like went off like
game
crazy.
Met big success on that one years back.
Yeah, and this is similarly a survival game that is on Xbox in game preview, and I'm really proud of them for getting this on Game Pass, because it means a lot of people found out about it that way and probably went on to buy it. And then I saw a tweet earlier this morning that was saying that this game had surpassed Fortnite in like played hours last week, or had an average of 200 minutes per player, which is an obscene amount on average. So yeah, really, really excited that this was a successful Xbox game and a great scoop for that team, I think.
Yeah. I do know for a fact, I mean, it's probably pretty obvious, but there are people at Microsoft whose job is to do exactly what you just said. It's to go out and go find games like this that they should target for Game Pass or for some sort of, you know, exclusivity. And this thing, yeah, Palworld is an Xbox console exclusive. It's on Steam. It's on Xbox. That's it. It's on Game Pass. And it's it has been just a roaring success out of the gate in 2024 for Microsoft. Travis, I'm going to read you a couple quick statements from the developers about a couple of the Xbox specific, I don't want to call them issues, but let's call them just unique bits, things that are unique to the Xbox version in terms of the player count and connectivity. So speaking in the Palworld Discord, developer Pocket Pair said those playing on Xbox or PC through Game Pass or the Microsoft Store cannot create or join dedicated servers, which means online co-op is limited to 2 to 4 players. Quote, we'd like to have dedicated servers on Xbox, but it's unfortunately not up to us and is quite difficult to negotiate at this time. But we are trying. So I've got another one for you, but I want to let you speak to that. I know you did say a couple minutes ago that you feel like that still works pretty well. So if you can maybe elaborate on that, and then maybe if you think your thoughts on if you think Microsoft's probably making those dedicated servers happen as we speak, given the stratospheric success of this game right now.
Yeah, I would like to think that they are, but not having dedicated servers is actually not that unique on the console space. Very few survival games have them. Grounded doesn't have it. You know, it's one of those games where if you're the main player, everybody else is playing on your account and they can make players in that world. But if you're not playing in your world, they can't play in it. So it's just a little bit inconvenient if you have a group because you can't play the game unless your friends are on. And the only survival game I can think of on the Xbox platform that for sure has dedicated servers is Minecraft, which they also did not have when that game launched. It was very similar. And so if you're one of those people who's willing to pay, I think it's $3 a month on Minecraft to have your own server, you can offer it to you and your friends, and then any of them can log on and play in your shared world at the same time. It's a pretty cool feature in Minecraft. I would love to see it in this game, but just based on how rare it is on console, something's telling me that that's probably a major lift like the developer is claiming. And I don't know if that's even necessarily Microsoft's fault. Like PC, just the fact that it's a completely open, unprotected sandbox, it means that like three different companies can come in and say, we are spinning up servers for this game and you can just pay us money and we'll give you one. And I just don't know if it's that straightforward on a kind of walled garden console ecosystem, but we clearly know it's possible. It's in Minecraft and it is something that Minecraft players enjoy. I actually have a subscription to a Minecraft Realms server myself because I'm a big survival fan. And so I would absolutely do that in Palworld. I think it would make the game easier to play with friends, not having to ensure that one person, the leader, is always on. I don't know how easy that is. And I wouldn't say that it's like a foregone conclusion that that's going to be added.
The community manager actually just released an update about their plan of action, basically early access roadmap, they're calling it. They're addressing critical issues. That's their top priority. Currently, numerous bugs have been identified and we are prioritizing fixing those. Sometimes the world date may experience roadblocks. The loading screen may persist when trying to load into worlds. They're trying to implement improvements to implement ASAP key configuration improvements, improvements to base PAL AI and pathing. And they're planning future updates, which include PvP raid bosses for endgame content, a PAL arena PvP for PALs, Steam Xbox crossplay, various Xbox feature improvements, server transfers and migrations, improvements to the building system, new islands, PALs, bosses, and technologies. By improvements to the building system, I hope it's easier to dismantle stuff, because once you build something, if you want to move it a little bit, you just gotta like break it with a hammer, unless I don't know what I'm doing.
There's a disassemble button, but you're right that you can't just pick up a chest and move it elsewhere. You actually have to break it down, but you do not have to do it with an axe. You can just disassemble button. But yeah, you're right that moving things is a huge pain in the neck. And I think they could make that a lot easier. So that sounds like a very ambitious roadmap, but hey, 7 million copies, that might buy you that. I'm imagining they're probably scaling up their team pretty aggressively now to strike while the iron's hot.
Are only Steam numbers, Ryan.
Yeah that's what I was saying earlier. Like, we don't even know how many people are playing this on Game Pass. They haven't released that figure, and it's got to be a pretty healthy contingent on the Xbox side as well. Now, Travis, this, you did also mention this, you kind of alluded to it a little while ago, and this is the other thing I wanted to bring up. So responding to an Xbox player who called for parity with the Steam version, you had said that the Xbox version is a little behind the Steam version. They said, let's see here, where have we got? I lost my place. Updates were lagging behind on Xbox due to the certification process with Microsoft, which, I mean, every game is subject to that, whereas PC, you just post the patch when you feel like it, and hope it's not going to break anybody's whole thing. That's the whole point of the certification, is that it hopefully doesn't break anybody's game on Xbox. But they said, let's see, on Steam, developers apply patches as when and say fit. Quote, some of these things will take extra time. We're really at the mercy of the certification here. We're desperately trying to speed this up. So how can you maybe, for any of our listeners, Travis, who are considering jumping into this game and maybe have a gaming PC as their option versus playing, you know, maybe in front of their TV on Xbox, can you speak to how either both sort of literally far behind the Xbox version mm-hmm. is, but also just more realistically, practically, like does it matter? Like, can you kind of address that?
Yeah. Yeah, so in terms of what's actually in the game, it's not like the Xbox is hugely lagging. It's not like it's missing certain PALs or you can't go to parts of the world or complete certain missions. You can do quite literally everything that's in the game. It's mostly about like how stable the game is. And as somebody who plays a lot of games before they're out, I'm kind of used to, I have a more keen eye than most of like how far behind a game is from being the 1.0 version, right? Or in this case, it's the early access version. And it kind of feels like a game that is like 3 months away from, you know, being released into early access. And it just has frame rate issues. It has a ton of pop-in. There are areas where if you're flying around, you'll notice that certain textures don't load and become kind of physical in time, and so you'll fall through the map and then you'll end up, you know, flying around under the map and have to find your way out, which is a pain in the neck. But it beyond that, you can play the game. The game is extremely playable. It's just a little bit unstable. You'll have multiplayer disconnects, which maybe is related to not having dedicated servers, and then you'll have hard crashes too on a pretty regular basis. Like, granted, I was binging this game, playing a ton, and so on Xbox, by the way. And it especially struggles on the Series S. And I know people are sick of hearing that, but just because all of the ways that it lags behind are like technical, I think it just being on the Series S and having that delay for like loading certain areas, it just doesn't load them as quickly. You'll especially have like instances of you know, seeing a super, super blurry texture that then, you know, materializes when you get closer to it, and that sometimes will lead you to falling through the map, which I did a lot. So yeah, it has that sort of stuff. But in terms of like, is it playable? Yeah, I played a lot on Xbox, like a ton of hours on it, and it's super fun with friends. That was how I did most of my multiplayer, because my friends wanted to play it on Game Pass so that they didn't have to pay for it, understandably. And so there's just like a large community there, and you can do everything that you can do on PC, with the exception of some weird features that seem like maybe they were overlooked, because I am under the belief that this was developed for Xbox with a pretty tight turnaround. For example, there's areas that require mouse and keyboard support, like renaming your PALs. On Xbox, you simply cannot rename your PALs.
Oh, okay.
Because they don't have an option for you to scroll over to that, and the keyboard doesn't pop up. And there's like little blemishes like that where you're like, okay, this was not designed with like controller support first in mind, and it's like very apparent. And so there's little stuff like that where it kind of might irritate you. But it's by and large, like, we're reviewing the Xbox version separately because it is so different. It kind of warrants a different context. But, you know, full transparency, I haven't scored it yet, but if I do score it lower, it'll probably be marginally lower. I don't think it's such a unstable game.
4 out of 10.
4 out of 10.
Yeah.
That is what the comments seem to think. When we said that we're doing an Xbox version separately, they were like 4 out of 10 at Xbox tax. That is not the case. I'm a huge Xbox fan, and I think the game is completely fine on Xbox.
We were kindred spirits when we met at that Destiny event, because we were playing on PlayStation.
That's right.
Yeah,
you're like, all this controller.
What you mentioned about, you know, the PC centric stuff that hasn't been sort of addressed in the Xbox version reminds me of when Tearaway came out for console, like late last year, I was playing it on Xbox right when it came out. Like they were nice enough to send me a code. And you couldn't invert your look. So I was like, well, clearly they did not think all the way through this on a gamepad. I'm sure it's been patched since because then I got into other games after that. But yeah, that stuff happens. And it's especially, you know, here it is an early access. It is an Xbox game preview. It is not claiming to be a finished game. It is still evolving. It is still improving at a rapid rate. But it's on Game Pass. So it literally doesn't cost you anything to jump in and give it a try, at least if it sounds like it's of interest to you.
Yeah,
I play it on PC Game Pass personally, and I'm having a great time.
Yeah, so PC Game Pass is actually the same version on Xbox, so it has some of the same shortfalls as the Xbox version. So it actually isn't a like it works worse on consoles thing. It is just it's a separate version of the game, and that version clearly. Yeah, clearly just hasn't been given as much love. Interestingly,
I'm still having fun though, just so people know.
Yeah,
like it's because I haven't experienced the better version. So for me, I'm just like, this is great.
Yeah.
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 Yeah, exactly. Totally great.
All right. Let's move to our next story here. Good. Palworld, big hit for Xbox to start the year. You love to see it. And like Travis so eloquently said, kudos to the what would we call them? Maybe like a.
Game hunters?
Vampire hunter that works at Microsoft, whose job it is to go out and hunt these things down and get them for the
platform. What a cool job that would be, right? You just go around looking at games that aren't out yet and trying to figure out if they're going to be good. That's cool.
I know someone that used to do that. I don't know if they're still at Microsoft doing that job, but that's I know somebody that did that.
The game cost $6.75 million to make and has made 200 and what was 7 million? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. $210 million. So good ROI on the investment.
And
apparently pretty good. Yes.
Yeah. Pretty good. Yeah. apparently the CEO of the company, Pocket Pair, has like talked about done interviews since the game came out, which are in Japanese, but they're translated, where he basically says like, this was the most scrappy project ever made on a shoestring budget with people who like never built a game before. And
they would make character designs on a flash drive and then try it out and then throw away the flash drive. Like they were just doing all this dumb stuff. Nobody knew how to use Unreal. So he had to teach them how to use it. One of the workers like was at a gas station before. And he's like, I just need people. Do you want to come work with me? And they did. And one of the people had applied, but then not. And then he ended up drawing a bunch of the designs. There's also the controversy, but whatever.
Games are cool.
It's kind of a cool story if it's just
think it's uplifting.
It's like ragtag group of people that came together to make something that millions of people are now enjoying. Mm-hmm. Speaking of enjoying stuff, we just have to take a victory lap on this next one, okay? Because we've been calling for this for years now. Microsoft didn't quite go as far as I would have liked and actually brought back the name Xbox Live Arcade, but they are doing what I've been wanting them to do for a long, long time. Once a month, the last week of the month, Microsoft says we will showcase our choices for 6 titles to be designated our ID at Xbox Indie Selects of the month. The whole ID at Xbox team will vote to select their favorites, and these are the 6 games that we feel confident you'll love. These are games that we want to put our stamp of approval on. Not only will the Indie Selects be featured in a special collection for that week, we'll also release a monthly highlight reel on our social channels and publish an Xbox Wire article to dig more deeply into which games were selected and why we like them. In addition, the developers will receive a digital award featuring the Indie Selects logo that they can show off on their own channel. So, if I may channel my inner Steve Carell from The Office, thank you! This is exactly what we've been calling for years, because this is the blessing and the curse with ID at Xbox. It's a great program. It's been going for over 10 years now. But so many games get published literally on a daily basis to ID at Xbox through ID at Xbox that even for us, whose job it is to watch out for this stuff, it's impossible to keep up with all of it. And it's like, well, which ones are the good ones? And with Live Arcade back in the 360 days, Microsoft built that in from the beginning. They said, well, there's these games coming out, but these are the ones that we're super highlighting. And, you know, Live Arcade Wednesdays, and of course, Summer of Arcade became a thing throughout, you know, once a year. And this is going to be once a month. And I am just over the moon that they are doing this. I think it's long overdue, but I credit them for getting it done. Because like we were just saying, these tastemakers at Microsoft, whose job it is to go out and sign these games, get them to the platform, they know which are the best ones. And so they're the ones that should be highlighting it for us on the Xbox dashboard, on their social channels. They're now doing that. This will help us, the players, find the best of the best of these games each month. And I could not be more thrilled. Destin, your thoughts?
I'm really happy to see this return. I love when they highlight smaller developers and give them a chance to see success, right? And putting them front and center. This is a great initiative. When I was in college, back in the 360 era, that was the platform that you could easily iterate for using Unity and then get your game out on the Xbox 360 platform. Fast forward to today, you can develop on whatever you want, and using the ID at Xbox program, which is fantastic, you can actually get budget for your games through, you know, Game Pass deals and such. So I really like what Xbox is doing to support the indie scene and allow these games to see the light of day. Very happy about this. I can't wait to see what they're going to show us.
Travis, you're a game connoisseur. You play everything. You play all kinds of games, which I salute you for and am grateful to you for, because you're such a great asset on IGN, just going out there, and you're my Swiss Army knife. If I've got, it doesn't matter the genre, I can say, hey, Travis, you want to take a preview on this one for us? And you're almost always up for it. So what are your thoughts on this, that of Microsoft finally doing some taste making of their own to try and better serve us, the gaming audience?
Yes, and I will try to do so without realizing the conflict of interest, because, you know, I'm the reason that you know if a game is good or not, and they're trying to beat me to the punch, you know. I think this is I loved the original program, loved it. Like I had to have them all if they were highlighted, because I didn't want to feel, I had the FOMO of like, oh, well, you know, if it's one of the four this summer of games, I need to try them all. And I love that. I do have questions about how this works in today's ecosystem, specifically with Game Pass, where that kind of is their select, right? Already, it's kind of like the, hey, here's the ones that we think you should try out and you can do so free. And so how does that coincide or maybe conflict with what they're doing with the Indie Select program? Because will some of those games be on Game Pass? And then therefore you have to kind of figure out which ones are worth paying, and well, why isn't this one on Game Pass when the other one is? I think there's going to be some like interesting like overlap there that maybe won't feel good to the consumer who's just completely uninformed and doesn't really understand why some of them are included in Game Pass and why some of them aren't. Because if you highlight a game, I think there's going to be an expectation from the Xbox casual fan base of, well, if you're highlighting it, why isn't it on Game Pass? So that's one of my questions. The other one is, are they going to have that got to collect them all element that they had for Summer of Arcade, where if you bought four of the five games, you got some sort of like big reward? Right. That was a huge incentive for me. And I don't, my instinct says that we're past that age of like buy two, get one free. But I kind of hope we're not, because I really liked that kind of that cool, you know, where they had the separate splash page that would show you, oh, you've got the bubble filled in on this one, and now try the other one. And I would try to beat all those games before the summer was over. So I'm interested to see like how fleshed out this is going to be, or if they're just going to have like one little button in the Xbox store or an ad on the homepage that says, you know, try these indie select games. So, you know, I think there's a certain degrees of how much effort they can put into it. And I'm really interested to see how the Game Pass thing goes. Cause if it were me, I'd say, you know, if it's on indie select, it should be on Game Pass, unless they explicitly said we don't want our game on Game Pass. And so I'm hoping that they're trying to do that. But maybe this is the opposite. Maybe this is a highlight of games that are not on Game Pass, and they don't include any Game Pass titles in there, and it's just sort of a separate program. I have a lot of questions about that, because times have changed since Summer of Arcade, and specifically with Microsoft business model. So I'm interested to see.
Yeah, all fair points. And you know, you did flag, you've reminded me of something I hadn't thought about in years, which was every Xbox Live Arcade game had a demo, had a playable demo. That was one of the requirements. If you submitted your game to Microsoft for Xbox Live Arcade, it had to have a demo. And maybe the modern day version of that would be great for this Indie Select program would be you know, because it's unrealistic to ask a developer to carve off, an independent developer especially, whose resources are probably pretty limited, to carve off a separate section to certify that, go the whole nine yards. But maybe there could be like a timed trial on it, right? Like where it's, you know, you've got 30 minutes to play it before you then either have to stop playing or buy the game. I wonder if something like that could evolve into this over time.
That'd be cool.
Yeah. Nevertheless, I very much applaud Microsoft here. This is awesome. If you can ask Phil Spencer, if I've harassed him about this over and over again over many years, and he will tell you, yep, Ryan wouldn't shut up about that whole Live Arcade thing. So thrilled to see this back. All right. Time has flown here. We've talked a lot about Palworld, which is what we set out to do. Before we go, though, I do want to do an Unlock Block trivia question. I feel bad. Stella's not here. She's down covering an event for us this week, down out of town. So she's unable to be on Unlocked. But you two gentlemen have a chance to score some points. In fact, I think that reminds me, I got to make sure. I don't know if I said this on the podcast, so I'm going to make sure to say it now. Although Stella's not here, I'll have to tell her privately later. But I owe Stella a point because the question
I saw.
Yeah. Okay. So the short version is that it was a question I wrote that I just asked all of you because we were low on user submitted trivia. And it was which studio that Microsoft now owns had previously been making a game for Microsoft before they were acquired that got canceled. And Obsidian was one of the choices, which is what Stella chose. And it turns out I had forgotten they did have a game called Stormlands that was in development as a Microsoft exclusive, Xbox exclusive, that did get canceled. So that means that Stella is on the board with 1 point. Destin, here's your chance. Travis, maybe playing a little for pride here, if nothing else, but I know you'll give it the old college try. Adam from Houston, Texas asks, following its initial launch, it's funny we were talking about Sega and the Dreamcast earlier in the show, Jet Set Radio Future was included in a bundle with new original Xbox consoles. This bundle featured a dual game DVD showcasing Jet Set Radio Future alongside what other game? So there was a second game bundled in here. Was it A, Panzer Dragoon Orta, B, NBA 2K3, C, Shenmue 2, or D, Sega GT 2002? So Destin, I'm going to go to you first, and then I will go Travis's way.
Sega GT, D.
Okay. Travis, do you agree with the seemingly confident Destin, or is he just pulling it out of his backside?
I think he's pulling it, because I definitely owned this disc, and I remember distinctly it was two games I was excited about. It wasn't one of those discs where you aren't happy about half of them, and I think the only one on that list that I was stoked about was Panzer Dragoon, so I'm going to go Jet Set Panzer and hope that I'm right. I don't think it was a sports game. I'm trying to remember the what the disc looked like in my head. But yeah, I'm going to go with Panzer.
Okay. I'm just getting Stella's point in my notes here. Well, Travis, you seemed confident. Destin seemed confident. Somebody's wrong. And as much as I love you as our guest, Travis, no, I'm afraid. Oh. Destin was correct. Damn it was. It was Sega GT 2002 alongside Jet Set Radio Future. So good memory on that one, Destin.
That game was always in the used game store. I used to go to game stores all the time around this era, and that game was always there on the shelf. So I can almost see it in seared into my brain.
Wow.
But yeah. And they're also were they both published by Sega?
Yeah, they're all four of the choices were Sega games.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Those were both Sega games. So again, that just reinforcing our point earlier about how Sega has been on board with Microsoft with Xbox since day one. Since
Sega GT was really good, I hear.
Yeah, it was a solid racing game. And of course, hilariously, Shenmue 2 sitting down there was the thing that I spent 2 minutes embarrassingly racking my brain about earlier in the show. And it turns out it was just further down in my notes.
Nice. That's hilarious.
I'm getting old. What can I say? It is what it is.
I knew it wasn't Shenmue, and I felt like it wasn't a basketball game. But I don't remember playing this game, but I know I owned that dual disc. So it's interesting.
All right.
Good memory, Destin. Good on you.
Yeah. We have just about run out of time. Next week, if we have time, I want to talk about Halo Season 2. It's not out yet on Paramount.
I'll give it a chance.
Yeah, there's the trailer's out. You can check out the trailer if you haven't seen it. It's, I think, a pretty good trailer But there's been a couple of spicy quotes from Pablo Schreier. The
Pablo needs to stop.
Well, I have some thoughts. I'll save them for next week. But for now, I want to let each of you plug what's up, especially Travis. You were kind enough to hear to make your first Unlocked appearance. Just finishing that IGN podcast bingo card. Congratulations. Yes. You get a free sandwich. Destin will be buying you that sandwich. So,
oh, wow. Cool.
Yeah.
Thanks, Destin.
Yeah. But yeah, cool. Travis, let people know, you know, maybe a couple of recent things you've written for IGN and or yes. where they can find you on social, as well as your own podcast that you hinted at earlier.
Yeah, yeah. So I write exclusively for IGN, and I've got a ton of content for them. We've got a preview going live tomorrow for a game I can't talk about, but that'll be on IGN. I'm pretty excited about. We've got this Palworld review, and then I'm also reviewing the upcoming Banishers: Ghosts of New Eden,
ooh.
Which will be a cool one. So keep an eye on that on IGN.com. If you care about me, you can follow me on Twitter at TyGuyTravis. If you don't like me, you can tell your enemies to follow me. That'll show them. I do a couple other shows. I'm on a show called BitCast on Sundays on YouTube. And then I do a Destiny podcast as well, because Destin Legere couldn't hang with Destiny. You know, he couldn't cut it. So I do that as well. But yeah, if you follow me on social, you'll see all that stuff. And really excited to be here with two of the industry goats. And Destin, thank you for inviting me.
Destin, quickly, anything to plug?
You can follow me on Twitter at Destin Legere. I've been playing an unhealthy amount of Enshrouded in addition to Palworld. I highly recommend Enshrouded. I really, really like it. That's all I got.
Excellent. I'm on Twitter at DMC_Ryan. Our IGN first game for this month. We've had a ton of great coverage courtesy of Mitchell on our team, Casey DeFritis on our team, as well as our IGN Japan team helping out with it. Lots of great Dragon's Dogma 2 exclusive content on IGN if that is of interest. But for now, I want to say thank you to Tayo, our wonderful producer who's literally technically made this whole thing possible. Thanks to Destin, and thanks so much to Travis for making his Unlocked debut and spending his time with us to talk Palworld and more. So thanks so much, everybody, for watching and listening, and we will see you back here next week.